Well, I sort of had sort of two tasks in this, and one is to sort of talk about the region regionally, but I also wanted to just respond to some of the things that Scotty mentioned. Because I sat in the White House in 2012 and 2014, and nowhere in my mind could I have thought that in one year we would have both the Kazakh and the Uzbek presidents in the White House, and have generally positive wishes. And so I think the Trump administration deserves some credit for refocusing attention on Central Asia. And Central Asia is very much keyed up with our vision for Afghanistan, our vision for Eurasia as a whole. But we heard a lot about Central Asia, not a whole lot about Russia, not a whole lot about China. That's a good discussion because we're bringing back Central Asia as sort of as an actor in and of itself. And I see the U.S. Doing that. And I think the visit is extremely noteworthy, and Nahar is going to talk about sort of the opening on the domestic front. But I think it we're seeing an openness to regional cooperation that I didn't expect to happen so quickly and so fast. There's still a long way to go, and there's still a lot of questions of where they go from here. But so far on the regional front, it is good. And I think this light liberalization of Uzbekistan really gives us, the West, an opening to re-engage, an opening to continue to push both on human security and ultimately, hopefully, human rights issues. But I do think it's very smart focusing on social, economic issues, accountability of governments and their representatives towards the population. And I'm very pleased to hear that the U.S. Is sort of focusing in on a lot of these issues. And I don't know if anybody remembers a report a couple of years ago that you and I talked about, and you grilled me on DOA. One of the things that in the report, we call for greater U.S. engagement with Uzbekistan if Karimov's successor turned out to be more liberal. There's a lot of controversy at that time, but I think we've been surprised ourselves that we've seen that. Now, last week's meeting, I would say it's very successful, but I also have to give, it's very successful for the people and very noteworthy, and everybody who looks at Central Asia noted it, but a lot of other people, particularly those on Massachusetts Avenue where there's a lot of traffic, noted the traffic. And so I think, we need to keep our expectations. Central Asia is still very important, but it is, one of many issues that the U.S. Is dealing with. But the message I heard from the various representatives of the Uzbek government and the U.S. Was that Uzbekistan was open for business. They are keen to improve their judicial sector, curb corruption, enhance rule of law, with the ultimate goal of sort of increasing investment, increasing cross-border trade. And I think this is very smart because 70% of the population is youthful under age 30, and they need for long-term stability, security, they need sustainable employment for that. And I think, Uzbekistan moving in this direction will enhance the attractiveness of the region as a whole. But I really, think we need to hold Uzbekistan, to its promises, because we've heard Kazakhstan make some similar promises in the past, and they make them again and again. But I think if we can hold Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan and really sort of help them actually not just pledge but implement the investor climate will actually improve. And I think that's key because, here we have 70 million people in general in the region. In individual countries, a lot smaller. But as a region, as a market, if you look at that as a whole, and Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan are the two keys to that. One is the economic power, and the other one is the political and population sector. The other thing I think we heard was that, Central Asia was a key focus of Uzbek foreign policy. And I think you can see that whether that was the Samarkand conference, which anybody heard a lot about last week, the Afghanistan conference again, the Central Asian leaders meeting in March, a real focus on the region as opposed to just all the big players outside of the region. And I think that's good. And one of the things, we heard about how many times Nurziyev went to Turkmenistan, Kazakhstan, the visit with Afghanistan. Yes, we did hear about the visits to Beijing and the visits to Washington, but I think they were, they just didn't compare with the sort of tremendous flurry of diplomatic activity within the region. And a desire for dialogue to solve regional problems. And that dialogue is beginning. The problems aren't solved, but that dialogue is finally happening. I think that's good. And as Scotty mentioned, I think we are hearing pledges of greater engagement with Afghanistan. If you asked me 5 years ago what was the vision for Afghanistan, it was to seal Afghanistan off,
right,
prevent it from doing anything, and to use Afghanistan as a means for security assistance to the region. Now I think we heard from the Uzbek delegation talk about boosting trade, energy, infrastructure, rail lines to really kind of pull Afghanistan into the region with the ultimate goal of hopefully bringing stability to the future. I think there's a lot of we'll see how this plays out, but I think it's a good vision. I think a lot of what we heard about last week, a lot of it was symbolism, but that symbolism is good because it marks a change. Because this is a region that really has not been integrated. This is a region that has had just debating problems after problems. Some of the problems arose from sort of the collapse of the Soviet Union, the infrastructure, the focus of each individual state on developing their own national identity, defending their own sovereignty. Some rose from, I'll be honest, President Karimov. I think no one will deny that. He had a sort of cantankerous attitude to some of his neighbors, especially Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan. The very harsh form of authoritarianism in the country, particularly after 2005, really led to an isolation, both a regional isolation and an international isolation. And I think that was a problem because geographically it's the heart of Central Asia. It shares borders with all countries, including Afghanistan, the most populous country. And it has a legacy from the Soviet era of strong educational institutions, strong industrial base, and to sort of have a regional cooperation, regional forward movement without that big engine in the middle was really hard. But I think we also have to admit that Karimov was not the only problem. I mean, the neutrality of Turkmenistan and the bizarre nature of that country fed into this isolation and this difficulty of working regionally. We had lots of instability in Tajikistan and in Kyrgyzstan. And Kazakhstan, it's been generally stable, the most economically successful country, but it focused using its energy wealth not on the region, but it focused in on building up this image of Nazarbayev as a global leader, the non-proliferation agenda, the UN Security Council seat. It hasn't been focusing in on the region itself. So I think this is a lot of some of the problems. There certainly have been cross-regional projects. NDN is one of them, but a lot of these projects were very much outside coming in, and they didn't have all these big regional implications. NDN was about shipping things through the region to Afghanistan. The Belt and Road Initiative, again, it's shipping things through the region, not in the region, and building infrastructure to connect the region so much as to sort of connect China with Europe. And even some of the pipeline, the Central Asian China pipeline, it's getting stuff out of the region. And so there really wasn't a whole lot of discussion of sort of a regional approach to sort of economic development, which I think, given the sort of youthful population, is key. Now, what's changed? I mean, first of all the symbolism of so many meetings, including the countries where the Uzbek and Tajik presidents hadn't met on a bilateral level for years. I think that's very important. I think the sort of the number of times Afghanistan has leadership has been to Tashkent, I think, is also important. And each is met with pledges to sort of increase cooperation, increase cross-border trade, and I think we're starting to see some of that. If you just look at the trade figures, an uptick in Tajik Uzbek trade, a tremendous uptick, I think it's 35% between Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. The opening of some of these borders, just this has led to more cross-border traffic, which in some places brought prices of some goods down, which is improving sort of socioeconomic conditions. All of this stuff is positive. The sort of loosening of the visa regime is also positive. You know, the ability to sort of talk about water, as Scotty said, you know, in the past it was an automatic no, we didn't even want to discuss these issues. Now it is, well, we're open to discussing, we're opening to solving them, we're opening to figuring out a way that we can work on this issue that will enhance Uzbekistan's long-term strategic interest instead of just the no. We are talking, they are talking more about, you know, and there's more cross-border electricity transmission, gas sales. Uzbekistan sort of pulled out of the unified power grid 9 years ago. And since then, you know, you haven't had a whole lot of discussion. We've had, you know, serious energy security issues for pretty much every state. We're seeing a lot more cooperation, discussions about, you know, Kazakhstan refining products in Uzbekistan, which, you know, reduces Kazakhstan's dependence on Russia for refineries. A lot of that stuff is very helpful. And so while the story is generally very positive, I mean, I think the fact that so much of this seems to depend on President Mirziyoyev, I think is a little bit concerning, because this sort of cross-border cooperation has not yet been institutionalized. I think, you know, a lot of this, you know, exciting stuff with Uzbekistan was happening, and you saw a lot of movement last fall at the same time when you saw the closure of the Kazakh Kyrgyz border, which was about a dispute that was largely a personal dispute between Atambayev, the former president of Kazakhstan, and Kyrgyzstan, and Kazakhstan's Nursultan Nazarbayev. You know, I think there is a real need in the region to sort of move beyond the personalized politics and the personalized diplomacy to have more institutionally based diplomacies. And I think this is key. I mean, Kazakhstan for the last, you know, 15 years has been used to being the leader of Central Asia. Now it's going to be challenged, and how does that play out? And I think, you know, these things need to be put into sort of regularized channels, particularly because we are going to be seeing leadership changes throughout the region, probably in the next, you know, 5-10 years, you know, several, you know, there's the big one we all expect, but who knows what's going to happen elsewhere. And so I think moving beyond this personalized politics, I think it's a great start, I think we need to, you know, the region needs to move beyond that. I think Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan, they have very good technocrats, both of them, very good, you know, civil servants who know how to do this type of stuff, and hopefully they will be empowered to try and move this so that you do not need presidential intervention to solve some of these issues. Yeah.
Thank you so much for
that.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure and honor to speak here. We had a really nice event in September following the visit by President Mirziyoyev to New York when he came to UNGA. And at that time, the story was, we see change in Uzbekistan. And change is in the air in Uzbekistan. And a lot has happened since then. It's been a remarkable journey for journalists like me who have covered Uzbekistan from here, you know, Central Asia from here, for a long time. We've been having so much fun covering Uzbekistan, I'll be honest. And no sleep, of course. You know, you can't sleep because you may miss tons of stories while you're asleep in Washington. But it's been a very historic time. I would use the word historic in this sense because the online Uzbekistan is very dynamic. And that's one of the best things that I think happened to Uzbekistan for the past 2 years. Finally being able to work with the journalists back at home, having that connection, and feeling like, wow, you know, as a journalist, I'm more connected to my audience than ever. And our audiences are not just in Uzbekistan. Our audience is the every Uzbek-speaking person in the world. But those Uzbeks are all looking at Uzbekistan and getting inspired, and the conversation is very rapidly evolving. And I could feel that when we had the delegation. We had a huge delegation from Tashkent here last week, and, you know, hanging out with dozens of Uzbek journalists who were here to cover the presidential visit, to also getting to finally sit down and talk to the Uzbek policymakers who are behind this ambitious reform agenda. You know, the Minister of Justice, Ruslan Bekdavletov, came to Voice of America to talk to us. And he gave us 1 hour, so basically we could talk about anything, on the record, off the record. And, you know, we had Senator Safad here, who is one of the most loyal soldiers, I would say, political soldiers in Tashkent. We had Akmal Saidov, Mr. Human Rights of Uzbekistan, you know, that's the nickname I've given him a long time ago. The guy who has been telling the human rights story of Uzbekistan for like 2 decades. And his narrative has been changing, so this was a great opportunity for people like me to basically corner him and say, hey, how have you changed? Have you changed? Like, you must change, please, you know, please change. So, but you know, his response was very simple. He basically said, I am still very useful. My ideas, my proposals still sell in Tashkent, and the government has been adopting my proposals. And some of his proposals, as he narrated, are pretty remarkable. So, you know, some people are good at, you know, changing, right, with the times. But there are some things that I think we heard from the delegation, from very, you know, high-level officials, that we should hold them responsible, try, do our best to hold them responsible, because they can't just stay and get away, you know? That's there. I've said it in Washington. That's our narrative, and that's where we're going. I think some of the things that, you know, we heard were remarkable and really news for Uzbekistan. Things like reform process is irreversible. You know, Uzbekistan is changing not because the world wants it to change, because people want change. And it will change because people will be behind those changes, you know? So Uzbekistan needs to evolve from what president wants to what we want and how we want and how do we get there? Who is doing what? How much human capital do we have? You know, you can't just brag about your massive human capital. You have to really stop and focus on what kind of human capital do we really have. Because the message from the government, from president himself on a daily basis, is that we lack expertise. We need people to be able to do all these things we want. And you know, so Uzbeks can't sit there and say, you know what, we're over 33 million people, we're very capable. Well, now that you want so much international investment, the world's businesses are wondering about what you can do. How much training, you know, do these people need? So these are like reality checks for the Uzbek people that, you know, that make them uncomfortable. And it's okay, they should feel uncomfortable because these are really massive changes that they want. You can't just sit there and want, you have to make them happen. So for me as a journalist, I really want to get into those details. You know, we can't just say, officials met, presidents met, here is the new strategic partnership. Well, the joint statement is just filled with all these interesting details and that's that. You know, for me, now more than ever, I think, for the Uzbek media, more than ever, and for everyone else who is watching Uzbekistan, who's covering Uzbekistan, we need to be inside, we need access to Uzbekistan, we need to really be able to get the reality, to see the reality from there, and that was one of the reasons why I myself applied for accreditation. I also wanted to check the system out. I wanted to test it because we know that, you know, we've been constantly told that it's changing, that it's getting better, and that the system should work, and you just, you know, follow the rules and follow the instructions, and that's what I did, and I got my accreditation. So, you know, but that's another level of, you know, major responsibility on a journalist like me, because I'm also, you know, my main job is in Washington, so I can't really be, we're not opening a bureau, we're not gonna have a permanent presence in Uzbekistan, but the good news is that it is open for me and for the Voice of America, so we can go to the country, look at the bigger picture, you know, check out the borders, how are things going there with the posts and everything, being able to discuss and analyze Uzbek foreign policy from Tashkent. I want to go interview lawmakers. I want to see what's happening in the security sector, you know, which is supposed to be fundamentally reforming. I want to see what's happening in the healthcare, what's happening to the Uzbek economy. So we really want to get this big but detailed story from Uzbekistan. So that was the reason why we've been so passionate and aggressive about getting this accreditation. One of the remarkable things that we heard from the Uzbek delegation last week was that Uzbeks need a new parliament. Which is, you know, again, I would never believe if somebody said that 2 years ago or a year ago, you know, because Oliy Majlis at some point had become irrelevant. And we can safely say that, you know, we knew who was making the policy in Uzbekistan, we knew who was in charge of the foreign policy, and the lawmakers essentially were just sitting there, you know, accurately speaking. Now we feel we have these empowered lawmakers, you know, diputats and senators who feel like the Senate doesn't make laws in Uzbekistan, but they feel like even in their advisory positions, they can do a lot of things. So whenever I talk to a lawmaker, mostly off the record, I sense this empowerment. They want to do things. They are worried about getting reelected because there is now politics in Uzbekistan. There is some kind of a political competition that's you know, starting to take place. Another remarkable thing that I heard again and again was that human rights situation should improve, must improve. There is no other way. And it should improve because we live there, because it's our human rights. You know, and that discussion, the open discussion of that is also, I think, it's very interesting. And when I talk about these things, there were vibrant discussions online about these issues. You know, so there is this virtual public debate that's going on that is parallel to the news reporting that we're doing on Uzbekistan. And these things were being discussed as, you know, President Mirziyoyev was visiting Washington. Uzbekistan wants to be a modern democratic state, earning the respect of the international community by honoring international laws and its own laws. So that is something that we should hold the Uzbeks responsible for. You know, again, they cannot get away just by saying these things. They have to follow up. Media freedom is crucial. I heard that again and again. And then, of course, there are challenges, you know, so how do we mitigate the expectations of our own people? Great, you know, the world is expecting a lot from us, but reforms should improve our economy, our healthcare system, it should improve our educational system, it should become easier for people to travel abroad, housing opportunities, or opportunities in general for the Uzbek people. Security services, you know, now the National Security Service, this biggest machine in Uzbekistan has turned into state security service, but that's not a reform, and you know, that's not enough of a reform. Now, what is going to happen? President Mirziyoyev, well, very often he talks about the reforms that should take place in this specific service. So we will be watching that, like how will it shape? What are these reforms like? What's going to happen? How will the internal affairs change in Uzbekistan? The Justice Ministry. So, you know, you can watch our interview. We did it in Uzbek and English with the Justice Minister, Ruslan Davletov. And he fully recognized the fact that Uzbekistan is very good at producing lots of laws. Like for the past 1 year, apparently there have been like 800 laws. That's a lot of laws. Now, you know, how do you work on them? How do you execute them? Do you have enough people to work on them? You know, the Ministry of Justice, for the first time I learned that has about 8,000 people, you know, staffers. Yeah, that's, and you know, so they're working around the country. And so as we're getting more insight from the government, obviously the heavier is, you know, the responsibility on the government too. But as a journalist, I feel way more responsible than I did before because I know more now. And as I'm getting more, you know, getting to learn more, I'm also like connecting with my colleagues back at home because there are a lot of journalists there who know a lot, but they haven't been able to report. So the challenge now is how do we help each other, and how do we, by helping each other, then how do we help people to get better at knowing? Because we all know that informed public leads to an informed government, and when you cannot have, you know, you cannot do reforms without an informed public and informed government. So if we really want to be that true ideal bridge between the public and government, no matter where we are, we have to get better at our job. So when I wake up every morning and get several messages from the Uzbek journalists asking me questions like, how do we report this? Like, can you help me to get to this person? You know, where we need training, you know, what are the best ways to access training? Or can we do a story based on this? Can we interview this person? I know Uzbekistan is doing better because that's what I you know, need to hear. So when Uzbek National News Agency about 10 days ago announced that they will cover the presidential trip to Washington through the Voice of America, to us that was an unbelievable change. And I kept on asking my colleagues in Tashkent, like, are you sure? Like, have you gotten all the green lights possible? Because we don't want you to get into trouble. And they said, hey, we've already posted it. we have others too covering, you know, we have journalists for us, working for us in the special delegation, but we want to rely on that. So there is some level of comfort within the official and, let's say, online media in Uzbekistan. They dare to explore, they dare to come up with their own ideas, and they dare to imagine, and you know, then envision these things. So again, the challenge is, how do we work with that? Well, you know, the biggest thing is, it's not easy to cover change, and this is we're just getting started. So you know, we have this very established ways of covering Uzbekistan. It's very closed, nobody talks from the government. Yes, you know, I've told it a zillion times, nobody talks. So we talk to the human rights activists, we talk to whoever talks, and you somehow build a story around it. Now, there are a lot of people willing to talk. And when you do a story, many people from Uzbekistan reaching out and saying that, yeah, I have this to say, I have this input, you have to get it. So for the Voice of Americas and the BBCs and the RFURLs of the world, there is so much work to do. And I think we also need to reconsider our own approaches and styles. So another thing that I heard from the journalists, So opening in media, they told me, these were the Uzbek journalists in Washington, they said, it may seem slow, but do not underestimate the awakening in local journalism. There is so much more coverage of the economic situation inside the country, social issues. These were never covered the way. And you know, there have been some remarkable stories in Uzbek media recently. And also, people are, in my own observation, people are moving from being passive followers to active followers. This is a very slow process. But now they also want to participate. So I think those are some good stories. But again, challenges are, you know, how do you go from this? President wants this, this is what we hear from the top leader, to do we really want this, and what can we do about this? And this may sound very simple, but that is where Uzbekistan is today.